Welcome everyone to my presentation. My name is Marcin Zajączkowski, and today I will introduce you Testcontainers, a tool making the container usage in integration testing much easier. I will do that in 30 minutes, and hopefully we'll not have more technical issues later on. Just a few words about myself. I specialize in automatic code testing, continuous delivery, and reactive stuff. I'm an open source project author and contributor, blogger, and trainer. I conduct trainings for Bottega IT Minds, very interesting consulting and training company. And today, it's a tool in action session, so we'll be about test containers. And so I can start with some questions about integration testing. And for me, integration testing is testing which integrates some different things. It could be some modules, it could be some components, could be external systems or databases. And the integration in a testing is done in a way similar to the one which is used when that system is running in production. I'm the big fan of unit testing, so I need to ask myself and you a question why unit testing is not enough, and the reason is twofold. First of all, we have a subset of problems which are not visible in unit testing. Communication with external systems, probably would be good to have that communication to detect those problems. And in addition, there are some other or similar group of problems that are possible to test with external systems, such as contracts, but it's not very feasible to do that in unit testing. So it's just easier for us to set up a database and test JPA queries than to do it in a unit way. Test containers, or containers in general, it's a paradigm or a technique to use containers to set up databases, external systems, and everything we want in lightweight containers. Test containers is a mechanism, a library to do it from our Java-based integration testing in a very nice, convenient way. It's Docker-based with extra support for Docker Compose, and similar as Docker, initially it was for Linux, but Docker is currently quite well supported on Windows and Mac, so that tool is also somehow supported on other platforms. For the historical reasons, Test Containers is built around JUnit 4. However, currently both JUnit 5 and Spock are supported, and it works very well. That project initially was created for Java projects and JVM projects. However, currently there are some other implementations in languages such as Go to do the same things in other languages. As it's tool in action, so I will move on to live coding session. I will just switch to... okay, my screens are somehow different in some different way. However, what we can do with a container? With container, we can just create the new container. To do that, I can use just void method, main method, and create new generic container. Generic container. It's funny to write and see my output on other screen, the primary one. And generic container. And with that generic container, I can use some image. I will use some pre-existing images to do not download gigabytes of data. I can wrap it with try with resources. And that container, what we can do with the container, we can start that container. It's nice. And in addition, to prove that it's up and running, we can execute some command. In that container, I will just do to cut some file from that container. And we have some exception to handle. Of course, we don't know what to do with that exception, so we add it to method signature, and we can execute that. Currently, the main method is executed. Docker it's available on that machine. It tries to fetch that image. It's all locally cached, and it should be executed. And we can see that there is no output. Of course, there is no output, as I should get std out. And I should use something, use it for something. Okay, it should be better. I should get the output from that container. Of course, I really like to write code in Groovy, and in Groovy there is no issues with semicolons. So I can execute that code, and we'll see the output. I can also use soft wrap to be more readable a little bit. And we should see that. OS release. OK. Thanks. So there should be an error. And having OS release available, we should see that there is something available. And our container is started and doing some things. However, we have Alpine Linux, which is nice. However, what we usually do writing integration tests nowadays? I would say that it's Spring Boot applications with some databases or external stuff. So we can switch to something like that. Preparing that presentation, I wanted to create something on my own. However, the guys from the Testcontainers team already prepared that application, so I just leverage that to show you some integration. That application is a very small application doing different things, and I will move to. There is a Postgres database with that application is intended to gather feedback from the presentations. And here for testing purpose, I have two talks, two my talks, and we'll be able to vote on that talks. And here is the data for our test purpose. And in addition, that application can be used to gather that feedback. So we have voting controller, ratings controller, and we can get some voting about our talk. And because it's a conference, so we need to be fancy, we have Kafka. So that the request is sent to Kafka, and then Kafka listener, writing listener is getting that information and put it in Redis. Why not? And after that, it's read on a read. It's read from Redis, and we get information from Redis about current voting. So. What we can do to test that application? First of all, we can just create a simple test to start up that application. So should start application. I don't know, we are not sure what the application should do. It's Spock, but it can be done in JUnit 4 and JUnit 5. So I will just start that application to see what happens. What will happen. And because it's Spring Boot application, Spring Boot test, and it should be enough to just set up a Spring context. I use here abstract superclass because I know I will be writing more than one test in more than one test class. Okay, we are able to, no, we are not able because I didn't start the right class. I will do that again. And currently we are running. We see that we are setting up Spring context. And it should be OK. But it's not. Why? We see some exception. And we see that there is problem with syntax error. And the error suggests that on conflict do nothing. It's not possible to do with H2. Because it's Spring Boot, it's a convention that if you have H2 in test available on class path, Spring Boot will try to apply that SQL on H2 database in memory. It's unfortunately not possible because it's not a standard SQL query and we need Postgres. What we can do to set up Postgres? Well, we can install it on locally on that machine, but it's presentation about test containers, so we can do it with test containers. Because that presentation is quite short, I will do some tricks and do some elements to speed it up. I rerun the test, and in the meantime, I will tell you that I just overridden data source URL to use test container, which will be downloading Postgres Alpine Linux container and use some database. Database is not important because it's the database which will be injected into Spring. It's everything is done automatically at runtime because we use a container database driver from test containers. So Spring, knowing that URL and driver, will be able to, test containers will be able to inject that database and make Spring connecting to that database. And in fact, we are able to execute Spring context, but the context is up and running. It's not enough. We would like to test something else. What we can do with basic Spring Boot application? Probably we can check health check. I will use Smog MVC here. Smog MVC is a default tool for testing web things in Spring. To do that, I need to make some additional auto configure Smog MVC to enable ability to inject a mock MVC field, and I can do mock MVC. Mock MVC is a way to test your why. Okay, it's private, it's Spock, so it would be fine, but let's make it protected. And I will rerun the test. And in the meantime, mock MVC is mechanism to test controllers in Spring application without setting up Netty, Tomcat, Jetty. It's done on mocked servlet API. It's very convenient for testing controllers, especially REST controllers in Spring application. So I use it here in my application. Okay. Unfortunately, there is some problem. We can see that there is problem. We expected. OK 200, but we've got some internal server error. Why? We can take a look at the result, and we see that in our body, oh, body starts here with that big font, it's not easy. With mouse, which is held in that way that I have, it's again quite easy to mark it, but we see that there is problem with Redis. Unable to connect to Redis, nested exception, blah, 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 so it's problematic. Okay, as I already told you, there is Redis under the hood, so we could add Redis to that application, to that test, and I will show you the second way how we can integrate containers with Spring. To do that, I can add a shared field. Shared field. It's something like static field in JUnit 4 and 5. Private. I would like to use Redis container, but there is nothing like that. So I will use just a generic container. I will name it Redis, new generic container. Not Kafka container, a Redis container. Not registry. Okay, it's a generic container. Generic container. In that generic container, we need to expose some port because we've exposed ports. And that port, I don't remember it really, so I will take it from my notes that port should be that number. And we need to tell a generic container with which image should be used. So we'll set up Redis with that image and with exposed port of a given number. In addition, we need to do one more thing. We need to put a setup spec. Setup spec is before class in JUnit 4, so it will be executed before the first test. And again, I will use some shortcut to set some two properties. Those properties are used to tell Spring that Redis is available at that host and at that port. The values are taken automatically from a container, so it should be up to date. We have a problem because we've got an error that container should be started. In fact, the error is right because we haven't started that container. We could do that manually, but we have a nice integration for Spock and JUnit 4 and JUnit 5. It's enough to write test containers from Spock package, and that extension for Spock or JUnit 5 will take care of setting up a container and, declared as fields in our test class. And now, coming back to Spring, thanks to those properties, Spring knows where Redis is available, so we overridden access data for Redis. And hopefully, this time, the application will be able to start, and the test is green, so our assertion in Mock MVC with health checked returned 200, so application itself claims to be up and ready to serve data. What we can do next? Probably it would be good to test some use case. So the application is for gathering voting about the presentation. So I have one test about that. To speed up writing, I have two utility methods to make a vote and to assert that given vote is placed in proper order. We can check it with when, and we can add that we would like to vote on my previous talk, Java 11 support options. And here we, let's say, put average, so 4. And then we could assert that talk got JSON, okay, with 4 and 1. So we got one vote with 4 as a number. And it should be enough to get that simple voting works. But in addition, it's integration test, so I could leverage that one test to do some more things and assert more things. In testing, it would be a code smell to make multiple assertions, multiple when blocks in unit test. However, integration test sometimes it's more convenient, it's cheaper to do that. As I like my presentation, I vote on 5, and now I can rerun that test. And we'll see if everything is okay. As you probably predict, there is one external system missing. Therefore, waiting for that error to occur, I will come back to my abstract integration spec. To see that in addition to Redis, we would need one more thing. Looking at the controller, we see that on rating, on voting, we try to send data to Kafka. Currently, we don't have Kafka available, but our tests, why? Again, I forgot to execute the proper test. Because I wanted to run test from rating controller. Sorry about that. So I will rerun that. And coming back to our controller, we see that we try to send data to Kafka. We don't have Kafka available, so we expect to have some error. We should see it in a moment, that the client is not able to connect to Kafka. Waiting on that, I can start to, okay. We see that we have a problem, unable to connect broker, so we want to fix that. To do that, we need to do a few things. First of all, I will enable auto startup for Kafka listeners. I turned off to not break the previous test. And currently, Kafka will be available, so it will not be a problem. And in addition, we have abstract integration test. So in that test, I can just add another field shared with Kafka container. Kafka container. And here we have a dedicated container. It's nice because Kafka requires some more things to initialize. And therefore, it would be problematic to do it on our own. In addition, we need to instruct Spring to use Kafka Bootstrap server. OK, we have Kafka. We enabled auto startup. So looking at the Kafka, I started the test, but looking at that container, we see that there are some different things set up here. Therefore, if you have a container already prepared by someone else, dedicated for our database, data source, or whatever, it's probably good to use it. If not, we need to do it with generic container, exposing some ports, passing some files, some configuration, and doing some other stuff which is required to do. And of course, it's good to contribute back to the community in case you add that container, dedicated container for some, let's say, data source which is currently not available. Okay, we are still starting, and here it's one of the limitations or issues with test containers that I will be talking after live demo, that it took, it's 60 seconds, but it's not true. The initialization was quite longer. However, I will come back to that in a moment. We see that there is some problem. I scroll up and to get some error, and I see that, oops, we expected to have one vote on four and four votes on five. But there is nothing with five. What's the problem? The problem is that using fancy technologies, here asynchronous events and Kafka, it's nice. It can help you to deal with some performance issues, with scalability. However, it also introduced some maybe not issues, but some complication to handle. As we send it to Kafka, listener takes it from Kafka, it can take some time for the application to get know about our voting. So eventual consistency is an issue here. Therefore, our tests need to be improved. And in that case, we need to do some waiting. We could add, let's say, voting, sleep 5 seconds, but it's not a very good option. In Java, in general, we have awaitability. Awaitability is it's a very nice tool for waiting in a good way. So awaitability could be used here to wait for that event to occur. And but here we have Spock, so I can use a dedicated tool available in Spock. However, awaitability can be used with JUnit 4, 5, Spock, some Scala testing tools. It's really nice. Therefore, I encourage you to test it if needed. I will start that and explain what happened. Here, as I said, waiting 5 seconds, 10 seconds, or it depends, because on CI server it could take longer than 1 second to get that response. Instead of waiting, let's say, 5 seconds and checking the answer, we use a tool like awaitability or polling condition to proactively wait for that message. So instead, by default, it waits for 1 second. However, every 100 milliseconds, there is a check. Is this okay? If our required data are available, if yes, the wait is over. So in positive case, usually we test positive cases, we just wait, let's say, 100 milliseconds instead of 5 seconds. Therefore, that tool is crucial, awaitability or that tool from Spock is crucial to have our integration tests dealing with asynchronous calls easier to work with, especially to make it running faster. okay, we are happy because we are able to run our tests with Kafka, Redis, and Postgres, and with await async or polling conditions, we're able to wait for the result. However, nothing is perfect, and there are some limitations in using test containers with in production or with testing production applications. Here, I already told you that there is one method to use JDBC TC, dedicated driver for JDBC, and it's quite nice, but there are some limitations. First of all, it can be only used with JDBC databases. Therefore, for Kafka, it will be problematic. In addition, sometimes we want to do some extra stuff. For example, provide configuration for Postgres in our configuration file. And with data source URL, we are able to do some hacks like TC initialization script to run some static Java method or maybe some other SQL file to insert data. However, it's quite limited. Therefore, there is another way, which I use in Redis. We can set properties to override, to tell Spring that a given database on a given host, on given port, should be used. And it's okay. However, the main issue with that approach is that Spring can cache its context in tests. It's really nice because it can speed up the integration testing. However, those fields, similar in JUnit 4, 5, and Spock, are created before the first test in our test class and are removed. The instances are removed after the last test in our test class. Therefore, if our Spring context is spanned across three tests, in the second test, we will not have that container. We'll have another container. However, those properties will be in cached Spring context, will be pointing to the old container. So we have problem. What we can do, approach recommended by the JUnit test containers team is to use that pattern. Can use another container, can use static block, and we can, of course, that field needs to be static. And in that static block, we can run our container. And that container is executed and will be up and running in the following test classes. You might ask when it will be stopped, and the answer is when our tests will be finished, or at least when JVM running tests will be finished. It could be okay for some use cases. However, in a situation, for example, we need MySQL server with different configuration. In that case, we need to work around some issues with two containers running in the same time. So it could be somehow problematic. In addition, there is a Ryuk container used by test containers as a side container to clean up existing containers. Therefore, even if our Java virtual machine will be killed with kill minus 9, the container will be container with Kafka or Postgres will be cleaned up. However, I'm not, that method is recommended, but as you see, it's not perfect. There are some limitations, and in some cases, you can use another method. For example, in that method, you need to use a dedicated configuration for Spring with post-construct and pre-destroy hooks to set up, for example, MongoDB instance, which will be set up before our Spring or while our Spring context is setting up. And after that, using, for example, add primary annotation, Mongo client will be replaced with our Mongo client, which knows about the container we are just set up. Can be used, for example, for Mongo, but for JDBC databases, for example, using some connection pools, it's more problematic. It's not just replace one bin in the Spring context. We need to do more things. Therefore, that the last solution I mentioned also is not perfect. Unfortunately, I don't know any perfect solution, and the test container team is, doesn't know the perfect solution as well. But I mentioned at least three different solutions, and we need to use the solution which is the best for our individual case. Okay, I will move back to slides to talk about more about the drawbacks and limitations. First of all, which you may, I already mentioned that starting with Kafka, for example, having Redis, Postgres, and Kafka took, let's say, 1 minute to set up those three containers. It's not a problem with Docker of containers in general because they are set up very quickly, but in that container, we have software that we need to set up, to start up. And Kafka or some other microservice, it can take some time to make it up and running. Therefore, using containers to set up the stuff can take some time in our integration tests, especially if we are running it on fresh host. For example, we have Jenkins with slaves, and we download gigabytes or megabytes of data every time. It's good to cache it locally. Another limitation is container-in-container pattern, which is considered as a code smell, an anti-pattern. And due to some security and stability issues, it should not be used to use container inside another container. However, very often we have need to do that. For example, having Jenkins run on Kubernetes as a Kubernetes pod, we want to run our test containers test in that Jenkins slave. And then we can use the container in container pattern to follow. But in Kubernetes, it's somehow problematic, and as I said, it's anti-pattern. And therefore, we need to work around, make some workaround to use, to work with that. And the test containers team, it's aware of that problem, but they even don't have a real idea how to deal with that, because integration with Kubernetes is a big piece of code to write, and that library like test container, there are no consensus that is a good approach to follow. Therefore, maybe you need to do some handmade solution, such as create those required containers in Kubernetes using Jenkins pipelines to create that stuff, and pass environments variables to have available in our test to leverage that containers available from Kubernetes instead of creating test containers if running on Kubernetes or on Jenkins. And another thing I was talking about is a need to deal with problem with having containers available in different test classes. I already talked about that. So you know it's not, there's some solutions, but there is no perfect solution to deal with that. As the key takeaways from the presentation, I would say my main recommendation is to write unit tests. Unit tests are faster, cheaper, easier to maintain. However, there's one problem. It's not only possible to do that. But as a rule of thumb, if something can be sensible test in unit way, do that. It's definitely a better way to follow. However, sometimes it's not an option, and we need to write integration tests. In that case, containers are very nice approach. In the past, we need to download install Postgres, Kafka, and other stuff to run it locally. Currently, we have test containers on containers in general, and test containers provides a nice API to manage containers in our integration tests. Still, integration testing in general is a hard problem. Therefore, I recommend to try to minimize the number of tests that we have, integration tests that we have. But if you have to write that test or want to write that test, then you have a nice tool, which is not perfect, but definitely help you manage your containers integration tests greatly. And that's all I have. Thank you for listening.